clothes on my back.
I can't even
my mother would say, I got food on my table.
I can't even count more.
Lord, I know that you're able.
I can't even count more.
Say, I can't even
count more.
I can't even miracles. I got miracles on miracles, a million little miracles. Yeah, miracles on miracles. Count your miracles, 1, 2, 3, 4.
I can't even count them all.
Miracles on miracles, a million little miracles. Thank you, Jesus, for the miracles on miracles. Count your miracles. 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all.
We'll be right back. Hey everybody, welcome to our Sunday morning service. We're so excited to have you with us. We're so excited that you took the time to join us this morning. And we really want to encourage you to participate with us as we worship and praise our Lord Jesus Christ this morning. It's such an honor for us to be welcoming you to the church this morning. And we're so thankful this morning that we're going to be joined by the team from the Boskrank campus. They're going to be leading the praise and worship this morning. But before we go into that, let me share something with you. I've got such a big message on my heart of thanksgiving because we're faced with so many challenging things in our lives today. We're faced with losing family and friends and the bad news constantly of just family and friends and relatives and colleagues either getting the disease or passing on. And so I just wanted to really engage you today and encourage you to focus all your attention on Jesus. That is what I want to encourage you with this morning. I want to encourage you. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 2 verse 4, the Bible says, no one serving as a soldier gets entangled in civilian affairs, but rather tries to please the commanding officer. And so I want to encourage you. There are so many channels every day that floods us with bad news. I want to encourage you to up your level of fellowship with Jesus every single day. Do whatever you can. Get away from the TV. Get away from your telephone. Get away from your laptop and focus on Jesus. It's the same as nourishing your soul versus nourishing your spirit. When you nourish your soul, you're nourishing your flesh, it's going to just create more and more bad news. And that bad news will go into your soul, it will go into your body, and it will eventually deliver negative results to you. And you're going to be disappointed, and you're going to feel like a failure, and you're going to panic, and you're going to be worried. But if you focus your attention on Jesus, if you feed your spirit, if you feed your soul, if you just focus on Jesus, I promise you today, because he's faithful, because he paid the price for you, because he loves you, he will come to your rescue. The Bible says the Holy Spirit is there to support us in our weakness, in the times when we're struggling, in the times when we don't have the answer. He comes alongside us and to support us. And so I want to encourage you to spend time in the Lord. I want you to open your hearts with thanksgiving and lift up your arms and come into his port, into his courts with praise today, to give thanks because he is faithful and he loves you so much. And so I want to encourage you with a couple of scriptures today. Ephesians 5 verse 18 says, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. I want to maybe rephrase that and say, don't be filled with all the things around you in the world, the bad news, the messages and all of those, but be filled with the Spirit. Debauchery means excessively engaging. And isn't that the way we are today? We are excessively engaged. We are under pressure to listen to what the media is saying. But the Bible says in Ephesians, be filled with the Spirit. The Spirit gives life. He who focuses his attention on the Spirit, it leads to life for you, an eternal life. And the other scripture I wanted to share with you is Philippians 4 verse 6 to 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. I want to encourage you to focus on Jesus. I want to encourage you because your Redeemer lives. Focus all your attention and energy on him. Finally, brethren, the Bible says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. If you don't have any power, if there's nothing inside of you, if you are feeling fearful and you are worried, you can be rest assured that you can rest in the power of his might. He'll carry you. Your Redeemer lives mightily, and he ever lives to intercede on your behalf. So fall back on that. With thanksgiving, lift up your arms this morning as we join together in thanksgiving and praise to our God. Amen. And so this morning, I want to encourage you also to, with that same level of thanksgiving, to not neglect giving. And I want to encourage you to give to God, because God sustains you 100%. God sustains us 100% every day of our lives. We're thankful at the barn that we've had no loss of any of our members. We're thankful because we continue in prayer and we continue to lift up the members before God as we pray for all of us. And so with that level of thanksgiving, please do not neglect to give into the into our ministry as we serve this community. I want to encourage you to go to our website and to go to our webpage. The details are there, and be free in your giving, because you're giving as if you're giving unto the Lord. The Bible says, "Give bountifully, because you're giving to the Lord, and the Lord sees you. The Lord sees you, and the Lord will see to you." Amen. And so this morning, I just want to remind you once again, in your daily walk, rather focus. Instead of switching on the TV first thing in the morning, instead of opening Google in the morning, why don't you open your Bible in the morning? Why don't you read scriptures in the morning? There's apps available. There's all sorts of things, but read encouraging scriptures every day, because our God is a consuming fire. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you so much that you love us, Lord. Thank you that you are on our side and that you fight for us in our corner. Thank you, Father, that you sent Jesus, who became the propitiation for our sins and the sins of the whole world. We thank you, Father, for guarding over us and for your protection. And we just release your blessing, your favor, your protection, and your guard and your angels over our family in this church and their extended family. We pray your blessing over all of us, and we thank you for your faithfulness, for your mercy, for your grace and your favor that is over us and that lasts for generation to generation. We give you all the glory and the honor this morning, Father, with thanksgiving in our heart. And we pray, Lord, that you will draw us to you. Draw us with cords of love. Draw us with your favor and your mercy as we give you thanks this morning in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Hello, church. If you'll just stand with us today. It's such a blessing to be able to meet together, whether it's here in church or online, if you're joining us online. But it's such a blessing to meet together, and we are so blessed to serve such an awesome God, such a worthy God. And today, that's really our focus, is pouring out our praise and our worship and our adoration on a God who is worthy, on a God who is holy, on a God who does all things well. So today, Lord, we just come before you, and we come with grateful hearts, hearts that are full of praise, hearts that are full of adoration, Lord. And we pour it all at your feet, because you alone are worthy. You are holy. You are a worthy God, a good God, a God who is faithful and kind and full of compassion and mercy. The list goes on and on and on of all the things that you are, Lord. And you do all things well. So we praise you, Lord. We worship you. We adore you. Be praised in our lives, Lord. Be praised by the words that we sing, by our hearts, Lord. Be praised, Lord.
You're such a good God.
You're such a good God, and we worship you, Lord. Worthy King, we worship you. We pour out our lives to worship you, to honor you, to bring you praise and glory and honor, Lord. Because you are worthy. You're our worthy King.
Worthy King, to
chapter 3, verse 20 says, now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can think or imagine, according to his power that is at work in us, to him be the glory. We glorify you today, Lord, because you are able. We glorify you today because you are true, you are just, you are faithful. We lift your name, King forever, King forever. We worship you, Lord. We glorify your name. Hallelujah.
Spoke those words, let there be light, and there was. Oh, and in the same breath the stars fell in line, with one voice creation cries, you do all things well, you do all things well. Sing, be praised and be praised.
Now unto him who is able. saw you come in my defense. My only song is hallelujah. Oh, we cry hallelujah. Now he never let me fall. Now unto him who is able.
We praise your name. Father, we pray for this word today that you would bless us, God, as we hear your word. And I pray that, God, your spirit would work beautifully and powerfully as it always does as your word is preached, Lord. I pray that, God, as your word is preached, that also signs and wonders would take place, Lord, as your word says that you will confirm the preaching of your word with signs and wonders and miracles. And so, God, I pray that as I preach through this word, you would even just bless people and set them free. And I pray that, Holy Spirit, you would touch every life today. That, God, you would bring freedom right now, deliverance and healing and breakthrough and miracles in every person's life that is watching this, Lord God, that hears the word today. Lord God, bless them, and may your spirit bring liberty and freedom in everyone's hearts and lives today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It's so good to be together today, and I'm looking forward to preaching this message, and I trust that God will just speak to you. Last week, I preached on changing your citizenship. I preached on how that God spoke to us through different scriptures and words that you and I are not called to live in the natural realm, the realm that appeals to our flesh, but we are called to live in the spiritual realm. God's word says in Romans chapter 8, verse 8-9, that those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. I emphasize that scripture, that those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. You can only please God in the realm of the spirit, which God has called us to live in. And so I want to lead on from there and encourage you today how the word speaks about you and I being the temples of the living God. We know that scripture so well, that you and I are the temples of the Holy Spirit, that comes from the book of Corinthians. And what's so beautiful for us to understand is that you and I have been designed perfectly in the image of God to carry, to have the Spirit of the living God dwell in us. So you and I have been designed specially and beautifully to contain, to be the vessels that hold, that contain the living God within our spirits. Man, it's such a beautiful, wonderful thing when we understand that and when we see how God has designed us like that. What I see in the New Testament is how through the life of Jesus, Jesus lived with the disciples. Jesus dwelt with his disciples. And so the disciples had Christ around them, and they could physically touch him and feel him and hug him and be in his presence physically. And then Jesus left. But the encouraging part is when Jesus left, he said to them he would come back. And he did come back, but he came back in the spirit to dwell and to live in our bodies, in our hearts, in our spirits, so that we could enjoy him. The trouble is with us as Christians and people here on earth is that sin and self is what comes in the way between us and God and us enthroning God in our lives. And so I want to speak to us today on scriptures that talk about putting God first in these temples. Man, I pray with all my heart that God's Spirit would lead us and would encourage us to live by putting God first in these temples. That we would live consciously aware that the Spirit of God should have the rightful place in my life and in your life, because you are His temple, you're not your own temple. And what often happens is sin and self sits on the throne in our temples. So what does it mean? It means that we often elevate ourselves in our own temples. And so little space is actually given for the Holy Spirit to dwell in your temple, in my temple. And I believe it's heartbreaking to the Lord. And so I want to stretch us today. I want to encourage us, because as we give space for the Holy Spirit to take place in our temples, and as we enthrone God in our lives, that's when God is magnified, He's glorified in our life. And that's when the power of the Holy Spirit can really transform our lives and live through us. I believe that as Christians, you and I need to come to the place where we confess to the Lord, where we confess to the Lord how little space we have given for the Holy Spirit to rule and reign in our lives, in these temples. I want us to understand just how grieved the Holy Spirit must be, how grieved the Father God must be when he sees how he looks at our lives and he sees how little we give space to the Holy Spirit to live in these temples. how we focus so little on the Holy Spirit. You see, I mean, God went through so much to give the Lord Jesus Christ on this earth and to go through the death that he did so that the living Spirit would come and dwell in us. He went through so much for the Holy Spirit to come and to dwell in us and to be with us. And yet we so often don't focus on him dwelling in us and let him lead us and guide us. It's so beautiful that the Holy Spirit wants to be your counselor. He wants to lead you and guide you every single day. He wants to touch you with his presence and lead you into the good things of God every single moment of your life. But the sad part is you and I as Christians, we care so little. If we're honest, we actually care so little by not being filled by the Holy Spirit. Why I say that is because although we want to and we desire to be filled by the Holy Spirit, we don't give him space and time to speak to us. We don't allow God to be put first, or we don't put God first in our lives. And it actually takes a bit of a forceful will in our lives to say, God, I put you first. I place you first in my life. And so I pray with all my heart that it would become our desire in our hearts, in our lives, to submit our lives to God so that in these temples, God would be glorified and put first. There's no other way that a Christian should live. There's no second option. The only option is for us to submit our lives as his temples to finally be used by God thoroughly and firstly by him as his temple. That's how God designed us. And if we're living any other way, it's actually living far off the perfect design that God has called us to live in. Your temple is sacred. Your temple should be sanctified, set apart only for God's use. There was never any other plan in God's heart for us. You're meant to be used only for him. And I believe we need to reverence and honor our design when it comes to our temples and how God wants to speak to us and use us. You know, I've seen many examples of how beautiful churches that would sit hundreds of people, if not even thousands of people, many years ago, were built and were set apart for the ministry. Big sanctuaries and huge theaters, style churches that were built, and they held the most incredible services where every Sunday and even in the week, hundreds of people would be saved, would hear the gospel, would turn to Christ with all their hearts. There would be healings and miracles and signs and wonders. And God would just be magnified and glorified, and the church of Acts came alive in those buildings and in those churches. And nowadays, sometimes generations later, hundreds of years later, you hear of those beautiful churches, those massive buildings that were built just for the church, are now used as office parks, as theaters for shopping centers or anything like that. And I just feel, man, I feel heartbroken. To have seen videos and pictures and read testimonies of how that temple, that place, that building was dedicated to God and now is not being used for God's glory at all is really sad. And it makes me think how it is just with us. You know, God has designed us, he's created us to house his presence, if we can say it like that, to house his presence, to enjoy his presence, to be used powerfully and richly by him every single day. But the sad reality is for many of us Christians, even us Christians that have dedicated our lives to God, we're not living the standard that God has called us to. And I pray that it would not be a heavy on you, but that God's Spirit would encourage us to evaluate our lives so that we would live for him. You know, remember the passage of scripture where Jesus comes into the temple and he sees all the people selling things and trading, and he sees all these people in his temple and he gets angry. He gets so filled with such anger and he tips over the tables and he shouts and screams at people and he rebukes them. And he says to them that this is the temple of God that is meant to be a house of prayer. And we've turned this place, he says to the Christians there, to those trading there. He says, you've turned this place into a den of robbers where there's just trading and there's got nothing to do with God's original purpose for the temple. A house of prayer, a house of worship. And he rebukes him. And I believe that with all my heart, as we see in scripture there, that God would have been, and Christ was so grieved. He was so disappointed and so hurt when he came in to see a temple that should have been used for God's glory, for God's presence now being used for trading, and a whole house of robbers trading and maybe doing things that were not glorifying to the Lord. And so it makes me think, as I read scripture, how God is calling us to dedicate ourselves, our minds, our bodies, our hearts, our lives to Him. God must be honored through your temple. So I believe that you and I are going to need to come to a place in our lives where we remove ourselves, our own will, our selfish desires and pleasures. Remove the self-life off the throne in our lives and put God first in our lives. So it's time for you and I to really personally and individually go before the Lord with all our hearts and say, God, I come to you in humility and I say, God, forgive me for placing myself on the throne in this temple, because it's never meant to be that way. It's time for us to look into our lives and say, what is it that we have got to get rid of in our lives so that we honor God and we put God first in our lives? Look at what 2 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 17 says. It says, therefore, come out from them and be separate, says the Lord. Touch no unclean thing and I will receive you. This was a letter written to the church in Corinth, to a body of believers. It wasn't to the lost. But he still said to them that the Holy Spirit was leading him to say, to come out and separate themselves from them. Separate themselves from all that was entangling them in the things of the world and distracting them, pulling them away from their God-given and God-called purpose and design over their lives. And he said, come out and separate yourselves and God would receive them. ESV says, therefore go out from their midst and be separate from them. Be separate from them, says the Lord. And touch no unclean thing, then I will welcome you. The King James Version says, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. And touch no unclean thing, and I will receive you. This is a powerful scripture, and I really want to encourage us, because sometimes we are taught that we can continue in whatever we want. And we can continue our lifestyles just the way they are, and it's okay. But God is so clear. He is calling you and I from His powerful word to separate ourselves, to take these temples and to dedicate them only to God so that God would be enthroned in our lives. So it's time for us to clean these temples. It's always time for us to, in fact, keep our temples clean. But I want to encourage you, because I know how overwhelming it is for many people. I know that many people that I've spent time with in the body of Christ, and as I've grown and always grown up in the church, many of us personally have tried, and we've tried and we failed. We try to clean these temples, we try to dedicate our lives to God, and we failed. And we continue sometimes in our old patterns or our old ways, or we fall back. But I want to encourage you to stay strong, to continuously seek God. Don't give up. And I know that in our own strength, we do fail. There's nothing wrong with making choices and will and decisions to serve God with everything. But I want to encourage you today again, that as you sit before God and you come before the Lord, you say to God, God, I need your help. As I surrender to you, I need your help. I want you to be encouraged that it is a work of God in our lives to sanctify us. And it's a work of God in our lives, yes, with our cooperation, but it's His work in our life to bring us to the point where He is glorified and where God works, especially in our lives, sanctifying us and making us holy and putting Him first in our lives. Let me read some scripture to you in a second just to confirm this. But while I say this, I want you to understand that I'm never saying that it's just only up to God and we do nothing. It's a place in our lives where we've got to come to the Lord and say, God, I surrender to you. I surrender this life to you. I need you. I need your spirit. I need you in my life to help me to get rid of these behaviors or to break these weaknesses in my life so that I would really put you first in my life. And with your cooperation, with your focus being on God, that God would fill you and empower you, God will do a wondrous work in your life. I want to encourage you not to allow your unworthiness or weakness or your many failures to discourage you. Keep going back to the Lord. And as His Spirit fills you and He empowers you, He will give you the strength. He will give you the desires in your heart to put Him first and to live for Him with all your heart. So it's a great work that actually God does when we submit our lives to Him, when we seek Him with everything. And I want to ask you to do that. Look at what Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20 to 22 says. This is from the NIV translation. And watch how the word emphasizes the work of God in your life. Because sometimes we just feel it's our work. And we get stuck in that trap and we often fail. But look at this, that how God will work and do this work within you. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing His will. Isn't that beautiful? May God, the Lord Jesus Christ, our shepherd, the one who was brought back from the dead, may He equip you. I want you to go in your own hearts right now before the Lord and just say, thank you, Lord, that you are the one that equips me. You are the one who empowers me. May He equip you with everything good for doing His will. And may He work in us what is pleasing to Him. Through Jesus Christ, to Him be glory forever and ever. Amen. So may God do the work. May Jesus do the work in your heart and in your life. It'll bring about what is pleasing to Him. You see, with our intention placed on God, with our heart attitude that comes before God, that is set on God, to love Him, to surrender to Him, and to place Him first in our lives, God will be able and willing to come in and to do His powerful work that only His powerful Spirit can do within your life. So I want to encourage you. You make the choice. I've got to make the choice to allow Christ to dwell in my life. I've got to make the choice to allow Christ to be the one who will dwell in my heart, dwell in my life, and be first in my life. And then give Him that room. Give Him that room in my heart to sit on the throne, to be placed first, and allow Him to begin doing His transformational work in my life, to empower me, to encourage me, to build me up as a child of God and to live for Him. You know, it's a very serious sin in our lives as Christians. It's a very serious sin in our lives to place our will, our intention, our desires first. And that's actually what happens. We don't see it as sin because we're not doing anything wrong when it comes to going out and committing evil acts. But it's a serious sin in our lives for us to place ourselves on the throne in our own lives, to put our own will and desires and our own selfish desires above God. And so often that's actually what we do, is we're living with ourselves and our own life and our own desires, self on the throne, and we're not putting God first. It's a serious sin in our lives that we've got to take before God and repent of, because it hurts the heart of God. It grieves God when He sees His temple being used as a place of trade, and we're busy trading God's presence. We're busy trading the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives for selfish desires and wills, and we're placing other things first. Think of it, how many times in our own lives we're just saying, I want to do this, I need to achieve this, I want this to take place in my life, I'm focusing on this to build my life. And we're so distracted by everything in this world. We are so, as I said last week, we're living in the realm of the flesh instead of the realm of the Spirit, where God is first and His Word is first. And so I want to encourage you to go before the Lord and to acknowledge all things that have been placed on the throne or been placed first in your temple and repent of it. It may be addictions, it may be self-preservation, it may be your self-will, it may be that you've elevated in your temple, you've elevated your addictions or something that pleases you, cigarettes or alcohol, because those things, in fact, any of our sin is an escape. It's an escape, and we try and find something to please us and to give us feelings of ecstasy in a sense. It may be a wrong relationship. It may be an adulterous relationship. It's got to be something, or it can be many things in our hearts that have taken the place of God in your life, that have taken the place of the Holy Spirit being the one that fills your temple. Many of us will acknowledge that we do certain things, that we have certain things in our lives, like maybe it's alcohol or cigarettes, or maybe it's some kind of addiction. And often we'll speak to people and we'll say, okay, if it's not got a grip on your life, why don't you give it up? Just for a few weeks, why don't you give it up? Now, obviously, with some of those things, it's we've got to give those things up permanently if they are dishonoring our temples. But we'll often say to people, give that one glass of wine up for a few weeks. And they'll say, oh, of course I can. And then you say, okay, do it for the next 2 weeks. And they say, no, but why? And they can never come to a place where they actually give those things up, because they have become crutches in our lives. They have become escapes in our life that we depend on them to help us in certain ways, or to make us feel relaxed or calm. You see, in many areas like that, that is when we have become enslaved and we put things on the throne in our lives instead of God being the one who gives us strength, comfort, joy, peace. I want to really stir your hearts to think in your own life. Have you got God? Have you got the Holy Spirit enthroned in your life right now, in your temple? Here's another beautiful scripture as I come to a close this sermon. Philippians chapter 1 verse 6 says this from the NIV. Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Another scripture here says, in New Living Translation, another version, and I am certain that God, I am certain, being confident, I'm certain that God, who began the good work within you, will continue his work until it is finally finished at the day when Christ Jesus returns. So I want this to really build your faith and encourage you that as you surrender to the Lord and you ask and you commit to putting him first in your life, the Bible says in this scripture as well in Philippians chapter 1 verse 6, that the good work that God has started in you, he will be the one that will take it on to completion in your life. That gives me peace and confidence that I know as long as I stay surrendered and put my eyes on Christ, God will do the work within me. That he, through his power, his spirit, his word, will do something special in me. I want to close off by saying, may we not be people who live consumed by the earthly realm. May you and I be so aware and plugged into God that we would live in the spiritual realm that God has called us to live in, empowered by his presence and his love. That's the place of freedom, and that's the place of life, where the presence of God rules and reigns and directs us and guides us to lead a life of prosperity in every single way. May God bless you as you continue to pray over this message, and may God just empower you. Be blessed, and we cannot wait to see you next week. If you would like to connect with us in any way, or you'd like prayer for anything, please, on the links below or on the YouTube page or the Facebook page, please just comment there, and we'd love to connect with you now. Be blessed, stay strong, and be in God's presence. Amen.